by the University Libraries, the Caroline Marshall Drawn Center for the Arts and Humanities in the College of Liberal Arts, and the University Bookstore. It has been my pleasure to introduce today's speaker on one previous occasion. I felt inadequate to the task then, and I still do. My only comfort is he requires no introduction. And I'll just repeat what I said before, that if you look at the Auburn seal, it has three words, something to the effect of research, teaching, and outreach. And when faculty members fill out their annual reports or apply for promotion and tenure, they have to account for themselves in all three of those activities. And our speaker today has been truly outstanding in all three of those activities. So I give you Wayne Flynt, and he's here to talk about his book, which will be on sale in the room behind the reference desk afterwards, along with punch and cookies, free.
Thank you, Dwayne. One of the few places that I return to campus is the library, even including the basketball coliseum, where I've had season tickets for 31 years, and the college football stadium, where I've had tickets for 33 years. I say that to protect myself from indignities and slurs later on. The library is the place I return to most frequently, and this lecture series is the one place that I most frequently return to. And Dwayne and Margaret, thank you for what you do. The bookstore, Margaret is over here day after day after day. And this is a celebration of what Auburn is truly all about, which is the life of the mind. And the continual generation of scholarship of such amazing quality, which we get to hear about in this forum, is absolutely, I think, the best recommendation I know of this fine university. As you know in a memoir, you rely on memory, but I, like most historians, am a bit uneasy about relying too much on memory. And so it has been my custom in the crisis times of my life to keep a journal. Like most of my female students, and incidentally this is mainly a female thing because I ask in graduate seminars over 30 years, how many of the men in the seminar kept a regular diary or journal? And there'd be maybe one timid hand go up. And I would ask the females in the class or seminar, and virtually every hand would go up. And then I would say to the males, don't participate in this conversation because you're not qualified. But I want to ask the women in the seminar, when do you write in your journal or diary? And almost without exception, the first response always met with nodding of heads vigorously up and down is when I'm unhappy. When life is good, when your boyfriend is just perfect, when your husband does everything you want him to do, you tend to not write in your diary. But when things are going the other direction, you write in your diary. And that's when I write in my diary. So my 17 volumes of diary reflecting some angst through life is heavily weighted toward trouble times. And one of them is the trouble time I want to talk about today. If I were to dedicate this memoir to someone other than my own family, which is in fact the real dedication, I would dedicate it to the collective future of Auburn, based upon Mark Twain's famous advice that I find the further back I go, the better I remember things, whether they happened or not. And that, unfortunately, is the collective institutional memory of almost every institution I've been a part of. Once you lose the generation that has collective memory, everything gets fuzzy. And I didn't want that to happen, and especially for the 28 years I was at Auburn. It's really important that Auburn people not forget what occurred here. Secondly, I'm informed by the wisdom of Thornton Wilder, who in one of the great dramatic pieces of literature in the 20th century, The Skin of Our Teeth, has one of his characters, Mr. Autobus, who's essentially an allegorical character, Wilder's everyman, say, "I know that every good and excellent thing in the world stands moment by moment on the razor edge of danger and must be fought for, whether it's a field, or a home, or a country, or I would add a university." So, with that, I'm going to read from 30 minutes of a passage from part of my memoir, which I call Bobby and Me. Living in Alabama, even for a brief time, leaves impressions. Sometimes good, other times not so good. One of my favorite novelists, Ralph Ellison, spent only a few years at Tuskegee University. But the Tuskegee experience and its machines, accommodations, and compromises, which Ellison interpreted as hypocrisy and betrayal, imprinted his fiction for a lifetime. Tuskegee formed the backdrop of Invisible Man, one of the finest American novels of the 20th century. Ellison penned a paragraph that is appropriate summation of my 28 years at Auburn, as of his 3 years in Tuskegee. "Well now, I've been trying to look through myself, and there's a risk in it. I was never more hated than when I tried to be honest, or when I've tried to articulate exactly what I felt to be the truth. No one was satisfied, not even I. On the other hand, I've never been more loved and appreciated than when I tried to justify and affirm someone's mistaken beliefs, or when I tried to give my friends the incorrect, absurd answers which they wished to hear. In my presence, they could talk and agree with themselves, the world nailed down. And they loved it. They received a feeling of security. But here was the rub. Too often, in order to justify them, I had to take myself by the throat and choke myself until my eyes bulged and my tongue hung out and wagged like the door of an empty house in a high wind. Oh yes, it made them happy. And it made me sick. So I became ill of affirmation, of saying yes. The temptation for the 3 decades I taught here, for all those who loved Auburn, was to justify and affirm mistaken beliefs while choking themselves until their tongues hung out. I worked for many Auburn administrators who impressed me with their integrity, their courage, and their dedication to the school which they loved. I watched these men and women resign offices they treasured rather than surrender their honor or compromise their sense of duty. I understood their affection. Like many of them, I bought in completely to the outreach mission of this university. I applauded my department's primary commitment to teaching undergraduates. I loved my graduate students and my undergraduates. I proudly watched graduate students' careers and lives unfold and recorded in my mind how nearly every one of them made the world better for their presence in it. I relished speaking with alumni who loved their alma mater sufficiently to be critical of it when necessary, as a loving parent corrects a wayward child. I bonded with a courageous faculty that would not retreat into classroom, laboratory, library, or even archive when ignorant and malicious forces threatened the integrity of their university. Auburn was always a good place. In times of crisis, it was often a great place. In the willingness of the people who loved it to remain and fight rather than to despair and leave. Alas, like all human institutions, it was also a deeply flawed place. A place so beloved deserves to have its story told honestly, without justification or rationalization, and that is the way I intend to tell it. My version is just that. It is a memoir, and no more than that. Other people have other versions, and they can relate their own versions any way they please. My tenure at Auburn paralleled Bobby Lauder's slow but steady ascendancy to control of the university, culminating in his takeover of the Board of Trustees in 1999-2000. Lauder was a control freak, obsessed with football, shrewd and manipulative, politically astute, willing to spend whatever it took from his vast fortune to win a national football championship and to control the board. He was the ultimate micromanager. If you want evidence. I'll be glad to read you some letters from the archives, which will pretty well prove my point. Bill had a single-minded purpose and tactics. He reminded me of the zealots who took over the Southern Baptist Convention in 1979. Not an analogy I suspect he would like, but one I find quite satisfying. Baptists became besmirched by their tactics and the fierce reaction to them. The strategy they used to take over the denomination, fragmented institutions, alienated fellow believers, and ushered in a phase of national scrutiny, withering criticism, and finally, denominational decline. Auburn followed the same trajectory. As with Southern Baptists, there were legitimate areas of disagreement open to alternative interpretation. That was true in the denomination, and that was true in the battle for Auburn. Were Bobby Louder writing this memoir or speaking today, he would offer an alternative version of almost everything I'm going to say. You ought to invite him. It would be interesting. One irony of the decades-long conflict was the battle to the death between two of my least favorite corporations, Bobby Louder's Colonial Bank and Goodwin Myrick's Alpha. My interviews with three influential Alpha leaders revealed that the source of their animosity toward Bobby Louder dated from his father's leadership of the company. They believed that Ed Louder's two decades-long tenure as CEO resulted in a suit filed against him by Attorney General Bill Baxley, charges later dismissed. According to them, Ed Louder was forced to resign by Alpha's board, which included, ironically, Emory Cunningham, who would later clash with Bobby over control of Auburn's Board of Trustees. As one former Alpha executive told me, one thing about the Louders, anything they're associated with, they are determined to control. In 2001, during one skirmish in a long war, I received a letter from a former history major turned salesman who had worked for Colonial Bank. The letter was personally highly critical of me and history teachers in general, who he believed worked very little, slacked on their responsibility to students, and couldn't survive in a world of true capitalism. One of those ego-massaging events in your academic life. But his embittered evaluation in the first two paragraphs of me was piddling compared to what followed in his indictment of Louder. I'm quoting from his letter. I worked for Bobby Louder and know him to be an evil egomaniac. He pictures himself as a wise man that knows what is best for everyone. He also looks at himself as a great salesman. The actual fact is he could not give away prostitutes on a troop train. The personal anecdotal stories, almost all of which are critical of me, all of which I quote for the amusement of my reader in this book, are just stunning. Shows Alabamians have a sense of humor, a bitter sense of how you can insult someone. Of course, ego, attention to detail, and the willingness to make hard decisions is not necessarily a bad thing in life. They assisted Louder in building Colonial Bank into one of the nation's 50th largest financial institutions. Bobby's siblings, obviously not afflicted with his compulsions, are widely respected as honorable, successful businessmen, public-spirited, and philanthropic. But obsessive devotion to a cause can be perilous ground strong with landmines, and so they were for Bobby Louder. Alpha, of course, was not innocent in this story. It had its own obsessions. So embittered at Ed Louder were its leaders, past and present, that some sought to block naming Auburn's business building in his honor, contending that son Bobby did not contribute the required funds for the building's maintenance fund. I know not whether that is true or not, so that's just Alpha's allegation. When Bobby Louder forced an alliance with Senate Majority Leader Lowell Barron pushed through the banker's slate of Auburn trustees, Alpha hired a private detective to collect dirt on Lowell Barron. The battle continued through various gubernatorial proxies, with Alpha funding Republican Fob James's campaigns and Louder bankrolling Democrats Jim Folsom and Don Siegelman. Actually, my personal relationship with Louder began amicably enough. He had been a fan of Hanley Funderburk initially, but when the situation at Auburn became untenable for Funderburk, Louder was instrumental in removing him as president. I observed over time that sacking former allies when they were no longer useful to him was a Louder tendency. I wrote Louder, praising his role in Funderburk's resignation. I suggested that if he exercised the same care in searching for a new president for Auburn as he had in acquiring Pat Dye's head football coach, that is, a truly national search, no requirement that he be a graduate of Auburn University, only that he be fully competent in his field, the university would be well served by such a decision. On the other hand, I began to receive troubling reports from other sources about Louder and trustee protocol. None was more influential in this memoir than those of Will Bailey, who had rescued the university from disintegration during the brief interim after Funderburk's resignation. A rigidly ethical Church of Christ layman and co-founder of the Alabama Poverty Project, on which I also serve, Will and I often travel to APP board meetings, though we sometimes talked of our common background of rural poverty and often about the state's larger problems. The majority of the conversations turned to the internal workings of Auburn. Will's story stoke my suspicions about Louder and the shadowy booster world that operated on the fringe of Auburn athletics. Louder, he told me numerous times, preferred a secret management style. He hated reporters. He hated newspapers. He hated publicity of any kind, good or bad. He made no public comments, operating with a cloistered world of secret meetings and private communication. When Bailey agreed to accept the interim presidency, he insisted on certain conditions. The response to some of them reflected the vindictive small-mindedness that would plague this university for two decades. Bailey, for instance, insisted over the objections of some trustees that Taylor Littleton return to the administration as, quote, academic advisor to the president, unquote. They reluctantly agreed to Taylor's return, but allowed him to occupy only a small chamber off the president's office and not his former vice presidential office in Sanford Hall. Another condition was the termination of non-public meetings where trustees had made all important decisions. In fact, public trustee meetings were sham, simply places where they officially acknowledged what had already been made in clandestine meetings. These must stop, Bailey told the trustees, and they agreed to his terms. At the very first trustee meeting, after Bailey became president, he told me, they reneged, conducting university business in secret as usual. Will listened with growing anger until they finished the meeting. Then he announced that when they adjourned to the public meeting that followed, his first act would be to resign as president, followed by an explanation of their earlier agreement with him and their prompt reversal of it at the first board meeting after they agreed to it. Agitated trustees talked him out of resigning and vowed not to repeat their offense, and they didn't during his term. He agreed to remain in office so long as they in the future kept their word. Before many weeks passed, a trustee appeared in Will's office on another inappropriate mission. Bailey listened impatiently and then responded, "See that name plate on my desk? It will take me less than a minute to pick it up and all my other possessions and walk out that door." The trustee apologized and intruded no more. It says something about the sixth presidency. The average president was president in a shorter a term than the average undergraduate was an undergraduate. That, so far as I know, Will Bailey was the only one who directly confronted the trustees and said, "I'm out that door if you do this one more time." Later still, the president got wind of a Savannah football booster offering a prize football recruit prohibited financial incentives to sign with Auburn. Bailey called Coach Dye, he told me, explained the situation and warned that if the player did sign with Auburn, he, Will Bailey, the president, would not enroll him, which is a good way to stop the booster problem. Despite such accounts and differences of personality and leadership style, the core of my dispute with Louder consisted and still consists of substantive disagreements about the nature of this university. The banker and College of Business graduate told another trustee he should compare the salaries of history, English, and other liberal arts graduates to business graduates in order to determine the value of various academic majors at the university. In an era, 1980 to 2005, when business school enrollment exploded and a Master of Business Administration seemed the path to America's nirvana of wealth and power, bankers and financial services firms grew rich on derivatives, subprime loans, and other risky financial practices that in time would bring down the entire American financial system. But at the time, risk-taking bankers such as Louder were the nation's new icons. Louder's wealth soared along with the bank's profits until the value of his colonial stock alone approached $200 million. In America, such prosperity commanded attention, and when such prosperity was devoted to a single issue, whether funding political campaigns, acquiring quiescent friends, buying political influence, or taking over a university, I'll guarantee you people listened. certain disaffected Auburn constituencies were especially inclined to pay attention. Alienated football fans who filled the presidential papers with letters such as those Harry Philpott and Will Bailey received, saying they meddle too much with what should be an entrepreneurial, unfettered football program where money purchased the best players. Agricultural commodity groups unhappy with presidents who reorganized their college and even appointed a black man in charge of university outreach. Alumni and even some faculty and administrators who believe professional schools receive too few resources during a period of booming enrollment in their fields. Older alumni who attended Auburn during an era when half of all Alabamians lived in rural areas and farmed. Remember, not until 1960 did the majority of Alabamians live in towns of more than 2,500. These people concluded that the university was indeed on the wrong path and had lost interest in them. Lauder laid out his arguments, and to a considerable degree their arguments, in a January 1992 letter published in the Chronicle of Higher Education. Selecting Clemson University as his ideal of land-grant education, a curious choice in light of the possibilities that you could have picked Cornell, Penn State, Michigan State, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, or for heaven's sakes, even Georgia and Florida for that matter, Lauder criticized his alma mater for deviating from its original purpose. Land-grant colleges, he wrote, had contributed significantly to science while adding practical courses in business, veterinary medicine, medicine, pharmacy, architecture, and engineering. Emphasizing the early tensions with an Auburn Polytechnic Institute, as Auburn University was then called, he noted that several presidents, notably William Leroy Braun, who was also a former president of the American Association of Land-Grant Colleges and Universities, had insisted that education devoted to culture alone did not fit a person for the active duties of life. Lauder wrote that teaching was Auburn's fundamental mission. I agreed with him on that. Research supported teaching. Once again, we agreed. Extension or outreach promoted a better quality of life for all Alabama citizens. Thus far, we were 3 for 3. But then the real agenda appeared in his article. Not everyone at Auburn shared his vision, it seemed. Some wished to see Auburn compete academically with Vanderbilt or Emory rather than serve the traditional land-grant function that Auburn has historically undertaken. The mission of Auburn University is really what is at issue, he concluded. As 2 decades of debate made clear, his mission was to de-emphasize liberal arts, strengthen professional schools, and win an NCAA football championship, though not necessarily in that order. In light of subsequent micromanagement of the university, meddling in academic standards, trustee demand for a change in policy that allowed students with failed grades to retake courses, pressure placed on 2 faculty members at Auburn University Montgomery to change grades, both of those pressures coming from Auburn University trustees, faculty understandably became suspicious of Lauder's rejection of Emory and Vanderbilt as role models. Could it be that Lauder's real concern was that Emory had no football team and that Vanderbilt had one but might as well not have? Perhaps Lauder's preference for Clemson had nothing to do with historic land-grant missions and everything to do with the admission of marginally qualified blue-chip football players. It certainly had nothing to do with the fact that Vanderbilt and Emory's academic reputations were beneath ours. U.S. News and World Report, September 2009, ranked the two schools tied for 17th among the 100 best universities in the United States. Clemson, for whatever comparison you'd like, was ranked 61st and Auburn 88th. For the next few years, as Lauder's control of the Board of Trustees increased, so did the number of partial qualifiers who signed football scholarships but could not attend without prep school or junior college remediation. Auburn and the University of Alabama had the distinct honor of leading the Southeastern Conference in signing players who could not be admitted from high school. We were 11th and 12th among the 12 Southeastern Conference schools. Trustee meddling in internal academic standards paralleled the trend of admitting skilled football players. Putting the best interpretation possible on the position that Lauder and trustees took, the issue was democratic access for even the most marginally qualified applicants, I might add many of them African Americans, regardless of whether they were athletes or not. Those of us who were more cynical concluded that the heart of the struggle involved finding ways around increasingly strenuous NCAA rules and attempt to improve Auburn's relatively low emission standards. This debate raged for a quarter century and I think probably is not resolved to this day. In 1992, I was appointed to a university committee on Auburn's scope and mission, which had grown out of a spat over Louder's letter to the Chronicle and my response to it. My chief contribution to that 1992 committee report, in addition to suggesting that one way to save money would be to eliminate agricultural extension programs that either were redundant or operated in counties that no longer had any farmers, I provided some careful research in university records using the archives a few feet away from us to trace the land grant origins of the school and the intent of many of the original founders of the school. It's like, what did the founding fathers of the United States really intend in the Constitution? Well, what do these archives say about the original intent of the people who founded and led this university? Unlike some Morrell schools, Auburn had existed for more than a decade before its incarnation as an industrial, agricultural, technical school. Its classical curriculum was far more typical of the Methodist college where it began than the land-grant university into which it morphed. Latin, Greek, philosophy, theology, history, literature, mathematics, sciences. These disciplines were considered quite sufficient to prepare graduates for the active duties of life, to quote Mr. Louder, whatever they may have been. I.T. Titchener, the first president of the land-grant university, merged the college's historic and new identities as a land-grant school. Incidentally, a Baptist minister, self-taught metallurgical engineer, brilliant businessman, one of the developers of the Bibb County coal fields, Civil War veteran and hero, though a chaplain at the Battle of Shiloh, got so mad he took up a rifle and shot two Union soldiers to death, one of the things he boasted about during his lifetime. But the point is, he was a theologian trained in Hebrew, Greek, Latin theology, and also a practical engineer. In his second annual report, July 30, 1873, he complained that, quote, men of letters who composed the faculty have little interest in agricultural pursuits. These nurses are guardians of the college's tradition, threatened to strangle or starve it to death. So there's the indictment of the liberal arts faculty, who are effete, unrelated, unconcerned about common people, and reject outreach. But, he added, farmers are prejudiced against book learning and pose an equally serious threat to the university. So there's the indictment of the practically minded person who takes book knowledge as something to be rejected. In his third report, 1874-1875, Titchener reasserted his fear of attacks from both ends of the academic community. The school's mission, he told trustees, was to teach agricultural, mechanical arts, and military tactics. And Louder quotes that, but it's interesting what he leaves out. Without excluding other scientific and classical studies, unquote. Indeed, the college's six professors, and there were only six at the time of the 74-75 report, kind of interesting to see what they were in this first installment of Auburn's life as a land-grant university. Professor of mathematics, languages, natural sciences, and moral philosophy. Two of the six taught what could be roughly considered applied subjects in agriculture and engineering. The other four taught the classic curriculum of the trivium and the quadrivium of the medieval university, which came from Cambridge and Oxford to us and defined American higher education before the land-grant university. Such a curriculum would not make a student wealthy or famous, Titchener wrote in his report. Not like traditional curriculum in law and medicine, the 19th century equivalent to the business school. But it would serve the needs of Alabama's ordinary people, and it would supply the state ways to benefit their countrymen from the university. Those advocating this new concept of education as a service to humanity must be content to be misunderstood, he added in his report, sustained by the consciousness that its purposes are right, its ends are pure, its methods are wise, and its ultimate triumph assured. Maybe. Maybe not. By hiring George Petrie a few years later to teach Latin and history, Auburn validated Titchener's vision and cemented the school's place in land-grant history. It was Petrie's vision of Auburn, more than it was President Braun's vision which Louder quoted, or Tischner's vision, which I quoted, which really shaped the modern Auburn University. If there is one true godfather of this university, it is George Petrie. A summary of my research found its way into the final draft of our mission statement. By citing Ollie Braun's conclusions in his letter to the Chronicle, Louder had distorted the university's history and made it appear overly simplistic. Whatever our conflicting interpretations of Auburn's history, a battle had begun in those years that would continue to reverberate into the 21st century. Although I disagreed with Louder's reading of Auburn's tradition, I was not entirely unsympathetic to his demand that resources be reallocated from declining enrollment programs so long as the procedures for that reallocation were uniform and were fairly administered. Although most liberal arts professors believe this was a malicious strategy of the trustees aimed at them, I believed it would actually benefit underfunded core curriculum courses in the College of Liberal Arts at the expense of declining programs in agriculture. The real, if you take a rigorous attitude that when you lose enrollment, you lose funds, the College of Agriculture is the one that would suffer. But the trustees decided that you had to hold harmless agriculture because they were an historic part of the land grant mission, whereas liberal arts was not. Go figure. Problem was, none of us believed trustees would implement a strategy of strengthening the liberal arts corps at the expense of anybody else, particularly the professional schools. In the winter 1992 issue of the Auburn Circle Literary Magazine, editors juxtaposed Louder's letter next to an interview with me as the polar opposite in this sort of ongoing debate. However one defined Auburn's mission, I wondered why some trustees would not aspire to putting the university's academic programs in the top 10 nationally, or even 17th, like Vanderbilt and Emory. That certainly was their goal in football, was it not? I wrote, could anyone imagine a press release from athletic director David Housel congratulating the football team for ranking 88th in the final NCAA poll? Then why congratulate us on ranking 88th among academic programs in the U.S.? It was revealing, I added, that Louder cited Clemson University as a model for us, a school without doctoral programs in most of the humanities and social sciences, but with a strong football tradition, instead of other options, like, for instance, the University of Florida, which in fact was one of the top 50 universities, not public universities, and had consistently one of the nation's finest football programs. By then, I had also served on the Civil Engineering Departmental Self-Study, where one executive of a top 10 American engineering construction firm asked to evaluate Auburn grads who worked for him, said that Auburn engineers had the very best values, work ethic, technical knowledge, reliability, and civic mindedness of any engineers he hired. But they lacked the breadth beyond engineering and especially poor communication skills necessary to move from wonderful employees at the operational level of the corporation to the executive and management levels of the corporation. I also chided Louder for refusing to come on campus and debate physicist Eugene Clodio, who was chair of the University Senate, about the issues which he had raised in his letter. Gene said, come on campus and let's debate the nature of this university. Louder never came on campus except to speak in a closed meeting to the Student Government Association. When my comments reached wider circulation in the Atlanta Constitution, I received some new fan mail. And as I say, the mail just gets better and better, so hold on. The writer announced in his first sentence who he was, a pissed off reader in or around Atlanta, and a self-described Auburn fan, whatever that was. Then he continued, I was an ass, an oaf, a dullard, a simple butt, a knave, an academic incubus, an incorrigible scapegoat, a carousing scalawag, or you're merely an elitist, airheaded bastard. Incidentally, that torrent of opprobrium tumbled out of only the first line of seven paragraphs. It got better as it went. The second paragraph did not advance his arguments much, but demonstrated that the author was a master of invective and fine prose. Attempts like yours to define what a university is are unspeakably ugly to me. Your incessant querulousness, indeed your booger-eating, bedwetting, hand-wringing, dirge cries for social justice, appease on the fiery enthusiasm of our children seeking enlightenment. Such critics, largely quiescent since the Funnyburg days, reappeared from the dark crevices where they had taken refuge 10 years earlier. Some nationally prominent Auburn scholars needed only one such letter from before circulating their CVs and leaving for other schools. Most Auburn faculty were like me. They had been here long enough and had sufficient scar tissue from earlier years, had bonded so tightly with their colleagues and students, and cared enough about this very special place to dismiss such incivility as unrepresentative of true Auburn people, or the only part of the Auburn family any of us gave anything about anyway. Okay. If I've not offended everyone, if you'll give me another 15, 20 minutes, I'll try my best to do so. But I thought you might have criticism, rebuttal, invective, though I doubt you can reach the levels of my friend from Atlanta. Or maybe you'd just like some further evidence, and I might add, you can do no better than start in the presidential and trustee records here at the archives, and then go to Montgomery and go through the governor's papers, especially the Fobb James papers and the Hanley Funnyburg papers. But tons of wonderful letters from Lowder, where he's, for instance, micromanaging the core curriculum in history and English, in response to Bert Hitchcock, who's sitting in the back of the room. Have I sort of put you all to sleep? Yes, sir.
I have a question, and I also have a book about Flynt. Do you think that Auburn is still lacking in the area of outreach? Because it seems like I'm a PhD student here, hopefully I'll graduate in the spring. And there's a lot of emphasis on research and teaching. Do you still see us lacking in outreach? You know, like to outside of
this campus? The question is basically about outreach and where we stand now and our vision. There are an awful lot of things. In fact, I have an entire chapter which I call, I start off with I came here in 1977, right at the front end of the Funnyburg affair, and so I call the first chapter about Auburn, Sweet Auburn, Stormiest Village of the Plain. And then my next chapter is Sweet Auburn, Loveliest Village of the Plain. And the chapter about the loveliest village is about my bonding with students and how much I enjoyed them. And the only part of retirement I miss are actually when I walked into the class, shut the door, and interacted with really wonderful young people. I also have a chapter on outreach, and that is one of the most positive parts of the book, the memoir. My own personal view is this. If you understand the evolution of higher education in the world and the Western tradition, which, like it or not, gave us the best universities in the world, by everybody's definition, especially the Shanghai rating system, Cambridge, Oxford, and 8 American research universities. And if you take the top 20, virtually all of them are either British or American. And that is based upon this classical quadrivium and trivium. And the idea was to prepare someone like my son, who came to Auburn wanting to be an astronaut and wanted to be in the Air Force and flying jets, and decided to major in aerospace engineering. And after 8 years in the Air Force, decided it was the most boring thing he'd ever done in his life. Wanted to get out. And he went to Pasadena School of Design and got a second degree in design, and now managed projects for Microsoft in Britain and Europe, and is now manager of software development for Precor Corporation in Seattle. How do you get from A to B, which is where most students are going in their lifetime? Well, the way you get there is learn to think and read and understand and analyze and solve problems. The second, Cambridge, Oxford is no less good at that, maybe a little better than Auburn. So don't worry about that. However, the single most important contribution that American higher education has ever made to world higher education is, in fact, outreach. And the assumption is a democratic assumption that just as everyone has the right to the opportunity of an education, which is the great American vision for education, everyone has the right to expect in a democratic society at universities funded by public tax money that they'll get their butts off the campus and go out and use their learning for the benefit of ordinary people. And we pioneered that in the College of Agriculture, which is one reason why I always admired the College of Agriculture here so much, because they were doing that. That's what their mission was. And even when farmers disappeared, Warren McCord and others were trying to say, okay, now it's community development. How do you save towns of 2,500 people and less? How do you make them places where all the kids don't want to disappear after they get their high school diplomas at 18? And so what we try to do here at Auburn, and I think we were the pioneers in the state of Alabama in this, was to take humanities and put it inside the model of outreach education. In fact, we actually used faculty members and contacts from the College of Agriculture. We networked with them. We said, who are the people in local communities who make them work? And we want you to help us make out a paradigm for humanities education. So Bert Hitchcock, who was one of the architects of this, Jerry Brown in journalism, Missy Kirkendall in university outreach, and others as well. But what they envisioned was out there in small communities, there were people who were dying of boredom. Not everybody's view of culture is watching the Alabama-Auburn football game. It's reading books. It's talking about music and art, history, religion. And so the Humanities Center took outreach to the community. That's the second area into which this morphed. Then Dr. Wilson, the African-American, he became vice president for outreach, and he grew up in a house in the Black Belt that did not have running water. And Wilson, a building on the rural studio, began to take stuff off the campus and to the Black Belt. And if you don't feel proud of that, you do not understand the basic impetus of democratic education unless you feel proud of what Auburn did across the board in outreach. And there were other schools that were doing some good things. University of Alabama with its rural nursing program and rural medicine program, UAB with the same kind of programs. But we were the leader in that. We had the vision of broadening that. And that's one reason that I always felt so strongly about the mission of this university. And that's one reason why Louder and I fought so, because his vision was to truncate and narrow the concept of outreach. Liberal arts is irrelevant to that story. Well, what world does he live in that is irrelevant to that story? Do you think people in rural communities don't read Chaucer? If you do, you need to go with Bert. Let him introduce you to some people down in Demopolis. Boy, the small towns of the state are just full of people who love that. And so to me, we've got a ways to go. You know, it's like civil rights in Alabama. We've gone 100 miles, and we've got 100 miles more to go in outreach. But that is part of this university that is just so enriching to the state. And I'll tell you something. Given the priorities of Americans right now in 2011, and given the battles between underfunded public education in Alabama and higher education, they have no endowment. They can't raise tuition to improve the quality of their schools. We can. And I'll guarantee you there are very few Alabamians proportionally who have children who go to college, and huge numbers who have kids in public school. We're going to lose that battle in higher education every legislative session unless we can connect this university to some purpose beyond getting you a ticket to the Alabama-Auburn game. Very long explanation to answer your question, but one about which I feel pretty passionately. Any other questions? Yeah. Tom?
What are the things that you think of as being distinctively Southern about Auburn University?
What are the things that are distinctively Southern about Auburn University? John Shelton Reed, Keenan Professor of Sociology at the University of North Carolina, served a term. Taylor Littleton asked him to come down, and he was a humanities scholar here for a semester. There's nobody more astute about the South in my lifetime than John Shelton Reed, and as a sociologist, he's particularly astute. And when he left, he said something that really interested me. He said, Wayne, you know, if it weren't for the fact that I'm so deeply attached to the Center for Social Studies and Advancement at North Carolina, he said, I really wish y'all would offer me a job. Because he said, Auburn is still a Southern university. Chapel Hill is not, in any real sense, a Southern university. And he said, I said, well, what exactly do you mean by that, John? He said, you have a sense of community. You have an academic sense of community. Your faculty does, and I think that's partly because we were bonded during all these fights. But he said, your students do. They have a sense of who they are, where they come from, despite the fact they have better offers from other places. Most of them stay in Alabama when they graduate. And he said, even when they leave, they have this incredible loyalty to Auburn University, anywhere you go in the world. If you don't believe that, you've not traveled in the world very far, and certainly weren't at Glendale last January with me. And I think John's right. I think that in the search for a national reputation or an international reputation, the first thing you jettison is your obligation to the community in which you live. So Michigan is the international university. Michigan State proudly proclaims itself the Michigan University. If you look at the funding trail from the Michigan legislature when times are hard, they increasingly fund Michigan State, and they say, Michigan, go raise your money in Japan if you're the international school. And so this is one place where I think Louder has a point of view which is well worth thinking about, which is, don't try to be the Harvard of the South. I'm just perfectly happy to be the Auburn of the South and do what we do well, because we do outreach a lot better than Harvard. Tom?
I was impressed by your reference to George Petrie as the godfather of Auburn University. The first two lines of the Auburn Creed clearly address the land-grant concept when he refers to work, hard work, and education that trains his mind and his hands with skills to make a living. And it's only after that he goes into the humane and ennobling virtues that may be associated with liberal arts.
Correct. Tom Vaughan's comment was, the first two lines of the Auburn Creed are basically born in the land-grant purpose. It's hard work, practical, applied hard work. And that work ethic then, as he moves through the Auburn Creed, gets broadened into the humanities, and especially moral values, which really reflects the fact that, first of all, he went to the University of Virginia. And if there's a better place for moral values in terms of education, I'm not sure where it is, as of course, pioneered by Thomas Jefferson. But the other thing is, he went to Johns Hopkins to get his PhD. And the third thing is, his father was a spellbinding Presbyterian minister, and he taught his boy what he had learned at Princeton, which was Latin and Greek and theology and moral philosophy and all that kind of stuff. And it's worth remembering that when George Petrie came to Auburn, he was not an historian. He was a professor of languages and history, and his primary responsibility was languages. And when he came back with a PhD from Johns Hopkins, founded one of the oldest graduate programs in history in the United States, and headed the history department, if you can believe this, from the 1890s to 1943. I was the fourth chair in the history of the Auburn department. And the department began in 1892. And I told them right away that I was not going to match anybody's longevity prior to mine. He started football. And there's an interesting story there. His major professor, Herbert Baxter Adams, who incidentally is in many ways the godfather to the modern seminar, brought it from Germany to Johns Hopkins, where students read original materials rather than someone's analysis of original materials, and from the original documents they form their own analysis of what ought to be done. And his professor took him to see a modern scientific, as opposed to soccer as in the European phase, scientific football was our American variation of soccer. And one of the things that Petrie carried with him to Johns Hopkins was a feeling of the insecurity and secondary status of Southern manhood after the Civil War. And he felt that by instituting this Northern innovation of scientific football in the South, it would make Southerners feel better about themselves. And so to him, this was like the seminar. The German scientific seminar was to history what football was to sport. And since you couldn't kill Yankees with rifles anymore, the best thing to do is kick their butt on a football field. So that was his vision of how he was modern. Football was a way of modernizing the South. And it's worth keeping in mind that not until 1926 did anybody outside the South take football seriously in this region. They all considered us to be backward. And if you look at Heisman and all the other great coaches who led Southern football programs, they were almost all Northern innovators. And the South was basically playing catch-up. We were mimicking until fairly recently. Now we're doing a little bit better. Yeah, I like Petrie a lot. And incidentally, a history MA student wrote a really brilliant biography of George Petrie. And if you've not read it, you need to get that. You need to get that that biography. It's one of the best histories of Auburn University without really being about Auburn University. It's about Petrie, but it's really about the heart and soul of what Auburn is. And incidentally, every time I see the line come on the big screen out at Jordan-Hare Stadium, it says, we believe in good, clean sport. And then read my chapter on on Auburn football and the scandal. You know, according to Gary Mullen, according to the interview we had with Terry Bowden, Gary Mullen, Larry Gerber, Barry Burkhart, and I had, which I go into in great depth, three trustees not only knew about the payoffs to players, but actually participated by giving $5,000 a year. Each 12 to 15 Auburn football players receiving $600 a month. There were $10,000 to $15,000 signing bonuses for them. Coaches were actually transferring the money, and one coach kept a record book of all the boosters, alumni, and trustees who were funding this. And according to Terry Bowden, Louder knew all about this. Whether he did or not, I don't know. But if he'd like to sue me, well, I can certainly subpoena all the evidence, including the account book. There are actually two account books, but Terry still has one of them with all the names.
Wayne, since we are in the midst of about a dozen new trustees, comment on your knowledge of the trustees and how they're selected and who they are. Yeah. And the qualifications and what you've learned about the trustees as such.
Alan's question was about the nature of trustees, and this is one thing that I think is really important to balance what I've said thus far. The problem is not Bobby Louder. The problem is not Bobby Louder. Long before Bobby Louder, there was Red Bamberg. There are Red Bamberg, who boasted that it took him three times to pass freshman English. Is that a real qualification for being an Auburn trustee? The real problem is that the way you got to be a trustee was you bought your way onto the board with contributions to the winner in a gubernatorial race. And if you happened to bet on the wrong person, you could always solve that problem by, after the election, going to him and say, I'm really, really sorry, and I'm sure you have some expenses left over from your campaign, so how much do I need to do to write you a check in order to get on the board? Incidentally, the good ones and the bad ones. Bob Harris did it. I mean, Emory Cunningham did it. They all did it. The problem is, you're not chosen because you really have something to offer Auburn University. You're chosen because you're a politically influential or big pockets donor, and that's the way you get on the board. And then, if necessary, in the last 20 years, to balance either gender or racial considerations, you may have somebody who really doesn't have very deep pockets, but who's put on there because they think they're malleable, won't cause any real trouble, and because you represent either African Americans or women. I'm on the board of overseers at Samford University, and I'll tell you the paradigm that I'm working from in the memoir. You'll read it if you read the memoir, but this is the paradigm. Private universities, and it's well worth remembering that in the U.S. News & World Report rankings of the best research universities in America, the top 20 are all private. There's not a public university among the top 20. And then you get down to a few like California, Berkeley, and a few others, but basically the top 50 are private universities. Incidentally, a phenomenal number of the top 50 don't have football University of Chicago, for instance. Chicago does not have football, but it does have 38 Nobel Prize winners, which along with Cambridge is the most in the world. So I don't know that they suffer really badly from not having a game. But the truth of the matter is, private universities tend to have boards of trustees like this, very big, very rich. They're usually corporate people, I mean good corporate people from like AT&T and Microsoft and like that. And what they do is they give lots and lots of money and they hire the president. And they tell the president, I'm really too busy for you to call me and tell me, as Bobby Lauder did, why the English department has three sequence of English freshman courses that meet 3 days a week instead of two quarters that meet 5 days a week, because I don't think that's the best way to teach English. That's a letter in the archives from Bobby Lauder to Warren Brandt. And not satisfied with the answer, and this letter goes on for pages, not satisfied with the answer, he asked Bert Hitchcock and Gordon Bond, chairman of respectively the English and History departments, to explain to him the pedagogical argument for doing this. Not satisfied with that answer, he writes a 5-page rebuttal to them in Warren Brandt's archival materials and says, I want to have a continuing conversation about this. Can you imagine what it is like if you're chairman, as I was, of a cantankerous group of people like Alan Jones and others, 21 of them in all. We have 30 graduate teaching assistantships. We have three telephones. Are you adding this up? 51 faculty and teaching assistantships. We have three telephones, no computers, maps that don't even list half the countries in the world because they're new. And we have one phone that's public for all of our GTAs and our faculty to use on the hall. And while you're conversing about private matters involving students on the hall, somebody's taking notes so that they can file a grievance against you for violating a student's freedom of information. And I get a letter from Bobby Lauder wanting me to justify whether we have 3 days a week or 5 days a week. Gordon and Bert answered very perceptively by saying, you know, it really helps in the process of analyzing material and reading material if you have a little space between the class. So that actually 5 days a week may work just brilliantly for some curricula at Auburn, but it doesn't work well in a discipline which is oriented toward reading, reflection, and analysis as opposed just to gathering information. Not satisfied. He writes another letter. Can you believe this? I mean, read the letter in the Warren Brandt papers and you will just say, what can they be thinking? Don't they realize we have 60 departments? At Sanford, they hire the president. If the president got a letter like that from a trustee, he would be stunned because they don't meddle like that. They're too busy. You know what they do? They fire the president. If the president is not doing the job they think he ought to do, they get a majority vote and they fire the president. But they don't micromanage the university. Very large board, lots of money. They get money. They hire a president. They leave the president alone. The president makes decisions, provost, deans, right on down. Big state universities tend to be like this. Big state universities have a stake. University of Kentucky, the stake is basketball. Alabama and Auburn is football. You get on those boards because you're not going to shake up any of that, and you're going to understand the alumni commitment to those programs. Secondly, the gift of money is really a secondary consideration from the trustees. Rather, it's the exercise of power. Sanford's board is three times. Sanford has 4,500 students, and it's three times as large as the Auburn board. And being on the board of overseers, which is the advisory part of the program at Sanford, I can tell you that on occasion I have advised the president that I would like to meet with faculty in order to hear their side of stories, in order to communicate with them. And the president said, I really wish you wouldn't do that, Wayne. He said, if you got a problem, tell me what the problem is. If you hear from faculty through grapevines that we've got a problem with faculty, you tell me. But don't start meeting with faculty and students, because then you're going to start micromanaging what we're trying to do. I understand what the president told me. I really understand what the president told me. And what happened at Auburn was, the president was not in control of the university. Bill Muse told me in an oral history, which is in the archives, he said, Wayne, I had institutional control of the university. Almost nobody else told me that. football coaches didn't tell me that. Chairman of the faculty senate didn't tell me that. In other words, the president thought he controlled the university, but subterranean to the president, all sorts of things were going on, including while Bill Muse was still president of the university, I had a corporate friend who was connected to one of the trustees tell me that the trustee had been promised that Bill Muse was going to be fired and that he was going to be president of the university. Well, Bill Muse hadn't gotten that word yet. It's sort of like Tommy Tuberville and the Petrino trip, I remember. Okay, one more question and we'll break. Very good, then we'll break.